Good morning, everyone. My name is Jana Swenson, and I am the consultant that has been working with the strategic planning team or the long-range planning team here at, I'm going to back up here so you can all see, at LCR. And we have been working hard to discern where God might be calling you to move into the future. You are getting close to paying off your mortgage as a congregation, which is very exciting. And so one of the questions is, how do you utilize the resources that you have to make a difference for the sake of the gospel? And many of you have taken the two surveys, and thank you, by the way, for taking those. We just got the results back from the most recent one that was facilitated by VRG, and that was very helpful for us. As a matter of fact, all three of the surveys, those two and then one that was conducted in the community, show that there's a great deal of interest and desire to make a difference in the community for the sake of the gospel. And so that's why this panel of local community leaders is here today. The long-range planning team has spoken with 11 different community leaders, and five of those are sitting before you. And our goal this morning is to learn more about the needs in the community. It's really the beginning of a conversation. It is not our goal this morning to solve all of the issues and the needs that are in the community, but I do want to encourage you to keep an open mind and really listen and discern what you hear from these community leaders. They all have a unique perspective, so you'll hear quite a good range of thoughts about the community. So this is the beginning of a discerning process, and you as a congregation will have an opportunity to weigh in as we continue this process. So without further ado, I would like to introduce or have the panelists introduce themselves to you, and then I will ask them a couple of questions and give them a chance to answer. Before I do that, though, I do want to acknowledge that you are doing some incredible ministry in the community already. And Pastor Dennis was just showing me this plaque that, was it last week you received it, from Matthew 25, which is an organization that you support financially, but also with your volunteer time. And it looks like Lutheran Church of the Resurrection received this in appreciation for your generous and faithful commitment to serve your neighbors. So as our gospel lesson talks about today, you are serving your neighbor, and we'll look forward to hearing a little bit more about how you might do that in the future. So I'm going to ask each of our panelists to introduce themselves, say their name, what organization they represent, and one sentence or so description of what they do. Ellsworth?
Morning. I'm Ellsworth Carman. I'm the director of the Marion Public Library. I've been with the library about 1 year. Our goal is to connect Marion residents and other users with the resources they need socially, recreationally, and academically.
I'm Stacia Walker, and I'm wearing two hats this morning. The first is being part of the Linmar Community School District. For the past 10 years, I've been their elementary student assistance specialist, where I work with a lot of the at-risk youth within our district, and then I also serve district-wide, helping to implement and train several of our district-wide programs. And then the other hat that I get to wear this morning is I serve as the president on the board of directors for Marion Cares, which is a faith-based organization in our community, and we provide after-school programming to several communities, actually within their communities, for those students, as well as we have several annual pushes to provide special events for those students, such as holiday assistance and getting back to school with backpacks.
My name is Chad Zaretsky, and I'm the Associate High School Principal of the Marion Independent School District. In addition to that role, I serve as a district liaison on a handful of community organizations and boards, just representing the district and having a district voice heard on those boards.
My name is Anna Clymer, and I am with United Way of East Central Iowa. We serve Lynn, Benton, Jones, Cedar, and Iowa counties. I always have to remember the fifth one, which is we fund them all. And we are mostly a community impact organization, so we really look at health, financial stability, and education components of some our community's well-being across those five counties. We also focus a lot on equity issues that are vital and important to our community members and being able to really fight for those access to resource and well-being for individuals all the way from birth to end of life. Small feat.
Good morning. My name is Carl Cassell, and I'm the president and CEO of Horizons, the Family Service Alliance. And we're most known for what is our nutritional health program, which is our Meals on Wheels program, as well as some of the meals. We also do mental health counseling, financial health counseling, and we have also a transportation service, neighborhood transportation service, which takes people to and from work after the city buses stop running, so overnight and second shift.
Thank you. So the first question for each of you to answer this morning is, what do you see are the most pressing needs in the community right now? You may have a long list of needs, but what are the most pressing, or which ones are going unmet right now from your perspective?
Well, I'll speak to the ones that I think are most pressing.
Hold the mic up real close, too, so everyone can hear you.
Sorry about that. Okay. I would say income disparity and the health, the lack of nutritional health of most of our residents. People are really struggling in those two areas, and the income specifically hurts the health because without the means to support some of those things, healthy food and the way you might eat or exercise is impacted.
So income disparity was the first one you mentioned, and then nutritional health was the second one. And is that for people of all ages?
Of all ages.
Okay. Okay. Great. Thank you.
I would second that. We fund almost 30 agencies in our community. That's urban and rural as well. And a lot of the needs really around those basic needs of just people being able to have access to services. We fund services to the Community Health Free Clinic as well as Eastern Iowa Health Center. And the inability for people just to afford co-pays and medication, and I think a lot of our congregation members have experienced that as well with increasing costs. Therefore, there's increasing burdens on individuals that are trying to not just pay for rent or transportation, they're also trying to ensure that their medical needs are getting taken care of. So some of those issues really rise to the top, I guess, for me specifically, because my focus at United Way is mostly around the health, but also mental health. Mental health is a big component of what individuals are struggling in our community with, whether it's because of impacts from their own childhood, whether it's impacts from kind of experiences as adults that they've not been able to control, but being able to support them in a positive way with decreasing the stigma around mental health and reaching out, because that in itself also impacts overall well-being.
So just to summarize, make sure I got it right, healthcare in general is an issue, and affordability of that in particular, and not just physical health, but and maybe more importantly, emotional and mental health. And there's a lot of stigma around mental health issues that we need to work at kind of tearing down so that people are more open to receiving the services they need. Okay, great. Chad.
I would agree with the income disparity piece. I think that's growing in our community. Income disparity is growing in our community, so I think that's one that's large. The other one that I would think is an issue that needs to be addressed is mental health issues of all ages in our community, and I think those are two areas that can use additional support and resources to help address.
Chad, could you give us just a general statistic about where you see in the school system the income disparity? Is there a place that you...
I don't have exact numbers, but I can give you a ballpark.
Like a ballpark,
estimate.
Yes.
So I know, I'm trying to think, right now, Marion Independent School District, the free and reduced population is, for the district, is around 35%. That's reported. I would say it's probably closer to 40 to 50%.
Okay.
Just because families sometimes, you know, feel that stigma and they don't want to have that label, so they don't apply for the resources. We work really hard to work with those families to help them get those resources for their kids. But that's in the Marion District. Linmar is around 20 to 22%. But both of those statistics have grown probably double in the last 10, 15, 20 years. So that's just a...
Yeah.
It's tough.
And that's something that we don't think about or would be easy in this area to kind of disregard. But for those of you who couldn't hear because of the mic, the number, the general ballpark percentage of students in Marion, the Marion school system, is 40% or so of students that are in the free and reduced lunch program. So that kind of gives a good idea of the income disparity. It's a marker for that. And the Linmar School District would be 20 to 30%, probably somewhere in that area. Stacia?
Yeah, that was actually kind of what came to mind for me as well, is the income disparities. And that growing free and reduced lunch rate, I mean, that's something that as schools we kind of report on. It gives us just kind of a feeling of the poverty level within our district. And like Chad said, that it's just reported. It's the ones that we know. And I have some numbers that I brought on my cheat sheet to make sure I got them right. But back 10 years ago, our district was about at 14, 15% reported, and now we're about the 21, 22%. In addition to that, the communities that Marion Care serves, they're up to about the 35, 40% mark as well. So I think that's a big thing that we're seeing at Linmar and at Marion Cares. In addition to that, I'd have to add how quickly we're growing. You know, we're a growing community, and with that growth comes more adversities and, you know, more struggles that we face. And since we're growing so rapidly, I think that's one of our struggles is with that growth, we don't have those supports in place that maybe some areas that have been facing this adversity a little bit longer have created for themselves. Just to kind of give you a little brief numbers for our growth. At Linmar, 10 years ago, we were at about 5,600 students enrolled, and this year we are at a little over 7,300 kids. So we are rapidly growing, and so has our need.
How many of you graduated from the Marion or Linmar school systems? A few of you. So you've seen a lot of growth over that time. Yeah. Ellsworth.
I think those were all really great responses, and I'd like to take it sort of a step back. I'm a really big picture thinker, and one of the challenges I think Marion's facing is with the rapid growth, there's sort of some concern about carrying on small town community values in the face of this population explosion. And part of that I think revolves around, it manifests as fear of some of the things that we're talking about. So concern over welcoming families that need assistance and things like that. I think the work that needs to be done is working on shared aspirations and to figure out what is it that Marion wants to be and how are we going to get there and how do we retain the pieces that we want to keep and how do we change those pieces that we want to change.
So kind of a summary there, and maybe we'll have you use this microphone as we go just so everyone can hear you, but and you can correct me if I don't get this quite right, but when there's a lot of rapid growth in a community, we find competing values. And so to sort through what those values are and find shared values, maybe between people who have been here for an extended period and people who are new, so that there's some common ground and some ways to move forward together in positive ways. Would that summarize it? Okay. Okay. So before we get on to the question about how would you see a community like LCR actually helping to conquer some of these issues, can you say just really briefly what a couple resources might be that are lacking right now? Obviously, money is a pretty important resource, and most nonprofits don't have enough of those or enough of that. But what other resources might be lacking?
I think a resource that's lacking is community understanding and compassion. And I don't mean that in a harsh way. I think Marion's the most compassionate community I've ever lived in. But I think we do need to really address the problems that we're facing and really compassionately working with those who are in need with the limited resources we have.
Right. Compassion is something we have as a church, isn't it?
I think, you know, obviously that financial piece is a big one, but I think the relationship building, you know, as a community is huge. Research shows what a difference relationships, you know, that impact on a student's life and kids' development is huge. And, you know, if we're able to reach out to, you know, our community and build those relationships and be those, you know, positive light in some of our students' lives, I think that will make a big difference.
I agree with the relationship piece. I think that's huge, whether it's an adult, a student, whatever it may be, just kind of that mentorship program, someone who's trying to develop those skills to be successful in our community and in our society, that having someone to kind of lean on and be that support system is important.
In being involved with this church for about maybe 4 years now, I've seen a lot of the outreach that this community is able to have, even in the jail ministry, with some of the community partners we do support, to be able to continue that path. And I agree with all of your responses in regards to compassion. It really is about finding ourselves in somebody else's shoes and figuring out how do we provide that support, not just to our young people, but also to our older people who are also addressing issues of loneliness and losing a spouse, losing neighbors, losing friends, and even when other family members aren't around, who's there to kind of show that compassion to them as well. That multi-generational impact that we can have in the community, I think, is important. We as a congregation, through some of the fellowship groups I've been involved with, have so much wealth of knowledge and history and skills that it's important for us to share those, not just within our walls, but outside of our walls as well.
And I won't belabor the point. What's been said is spot on. I was going to say resources and mentorship. All of us enter different stages in our lives, but we need people to come alongside and kind of walk us through those. So whether they're circumstances or a different stage in our lives, people are needing mentors, and we're lacking in that area.
So that's a real practical resource and way that church community or individuals can help is in mentoring or coming alongside another person, whether it's a young person or another older person who might have some specific needs and no family in the community. One thing I think the rising cost of nursing homes and services for seniors, more and more people are staying in their own home longer, which means there are specific needs that they have then in their home. And that's a great place to help make a practical difference, I think. But let's move on to the real tangible. So if this community said to each of you, we want to share generously our resources with you, and our resources include money, use of our space, volunteer time and energy. Since we're in the dreaming stage, and this is the dreaming stage, so again, there's a lot between here and where we go. We don't know where we're going to end up here. This is a process and a dialogue, but we're going to let them dream because they never have enough resources. So let's pretend this morning and give them unlimited resources to use. How would you use those resources?
I'll start. Okay. I would say for Horizons, as I mentioned, our Meals on Wheels program, we always need people that work in the kitchen, obviously, people that deliver meals, in our financial health department, volunteers who can come and help mentor folks that are having some financial stressors or just need guidance on some of those things. And just overall, when you think of resources, just able bodies, and of course, usually finances. We can't, we're in a people business, we can't do the work without the adequate resources for people to go out and do that work.
I think one of the things with being able to have access to space is how do we invite community in, not just to share who we are as people, as givers, as neighbors, but also to share those resources, because sometimes space is the shortage that people have for activities that they want to do, either with their neighbors or with children. I don't know how many of you got to experience the Easter egg hunt that was here, but there were a lot of people that came here for that day. And just being able to utilize our space in as a welcoming community, being able to provide other services locally here, because a lot of, you know, it is true, a lot of our rural partners and even our Marion partners see that the majority of the resources are really centered around Cedar Rapids and downtown, and how do we bring services out here, whether it's a clinic that may be a need for our neighbors that are part of this congregation and part of the neighborhood, whether it's a service, whether it's financial literacy classes, whatever it is, how do we invite others that need the space that we can bring together people to really access those resources more easily if transportation or other issues are a barrier for them?
I look at the needs our kids have just based on family situations. And I think that there are a lot of families that are in, I don't know, dire straits and in tough situations financially for a variety of reasons. And allowing those families and those parents who may be working two or three jobs at minimum wage to try to make ends meet for their families an opportunity to take advantage of continuing education to further their own education so they can, you know, maybe achieve a better paying job to better provide for their family. And I think whether that's a financial support collaboration with Kirkwood Community College, Marion and Linmar Schools, you know, the financial support there, providing space for the training to take place here, childcare so that they have someone to watch their kids while they're taking classes and doing those sorts of things. I think those are ways that we can help provide resources for those families to better their situations, and I guess that would be my two cents on that.
I would have to say really partnering with Marion Cares would be amazing. I think that partnership between Marion Cares and Linmar and Marion Schools, you know, really kind of helps filter where all of our needs need to go, where our efforts need to go. And, you know, through Marion Cares with our after-school programming that we have, we need those bodies, those able bodies to come and assist, be there with the kids, be those mentors. We're also looking at expanding some of our programming to, you know, adult nurturing things, you know, how to help them improve their lives, you know, move forward, get out of the cycle of poverty. And then also, you know, not only volunteering at our after-school programs, but also our annual pushes, like our holiday assistance, where we make sure that every kid gets a Christmas that might not otherwise, that we make sure that the kids show up to school on the first day of school with a new backpack and school supplies that they need to be successful at school. We also do trunk or treat, where the kids get to come and have a safe Halloween experience, where we also give out hats and mittens and things to help them through the winter time. So a lot of that, I think, is just giving time and efforts towards Marion Cares to kind of help filter throughout our community.
Yeah, I think investing resources in youth is always a really safe decision. And in Marion, I think that the potential that what I'm learning about this congregation could give to people they're engaging is a sense of community involvement and investment. I'm inspired that this group of people is having these conversations and is looking for ways to give back in a really meaningful way. I think especially in our community, youth need support who aren't the easy youth to work with. So they're not the youth that mom and dad are gonna drop them off right on time and pick them up right on time, and they had a healthy dinner beforehand. They're the youth that are a little squirrely, a little harder to rein in, that you might have to go pick up. But I think that those are the kids in the community that really could benefit from some mentorship and more adult interaction.
Well, I realize we've only scratched the surface here, and it's clear that you all are very passionate about the people groups and the people in the community that you serve, and it's very inspiring because we know you're working hard for the sake of those people. Can we thank our panelists for being here this morning?